the 17th century Englishman was exposed to.
Archer, you have this manual when he falls to the next photo.
Something that's easy to shove out there and easy to swallow. But I think it.
Original photos that were stitched together to
make
the photos.
We had created passionate and powerful. I guess
we
love it.
I've been told by him.
It's a great display.
Yeah, looks that really. Got any lines or anything?
Great.
So you can put video into worlds now, or?
Literally. And so how is the use of cyberspace for time and response?
Hi, John.
Benji,
going to the Halloween zone of this TV here. We're going.
Where'd you get those?
The kitties.
Ooh.
Kitties costume.
Process, because it's been converted into what we call the
Latin world. anything to do with us and moss.
Oh, so you, like, you only go to worlds where you have to have view from head to toe.
Time to leave for Bose.
Right. Oh, there we go. The bit.
Yeah.
Avatars tonight. We will unveil this woman this evening. She will come.
Yes. Can you open the door?
See the freedom of the Middle Eastern woman tonight.
We're not here.
It's all one of those progressive parties where you kind of go.
Tonight.
All these avatars were done by Stasha McGee over at iLive, and I'm pretty impressed with her artwork here. All these, by the way, all these have been very low polygon, excellent use of just the, just what. It's getting angry here. It's angry alien. It's the alien model. One of the more original ones. Carl?
Like this.
Okay. I'm a star.
Hey, and we're articulated. We have facial expressions.
These are avastars.
These are avastars. Avastars. Yay! Hey, Mithra. Girls chat. Yay! Realistic.
What's your
name? A bandwidth link. Hey!
It was small file size. One of the things that we looked at for all of them, we didn't want to any of the categories.
Expressions.
You got to hear the audio with this. This is up on Protozoa's webpage. You know what? I don't think we know the individual author over there. I met him today, too. This came out of Ken's truck, I guess, somebody's telling me. Okay, Ken. Who's he? What's up? Did we have a second operator? This one up on your own monitor. Oh, here we go. This is good.
Where is it?
I don't know. Smart is the word here.
I'm
going to
here. You have that
one.
You don't go back.
You can't fit these balloons in one elevator. There's no way you can fit these balloons in one elevator. You're going to have to go separately. You're going to
special effects.
There's static electricity avatar, Stephanie Sutton.
So you guys remember from the Muppet movie when Gonzo bought all the...
There's no room for you, Brett.
I'm getting in.
Come on, you guys.
So happy!
You are so happy. It's a blue M&M. It's a blue M&M.
Implant. I have one under my breast.
Wait. One more time.
That's under.
I know.
Is that better?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay, and this is multiple crickets. For Carla.
Yeah.
Three
chords. And it bounces up.
And then it's got lava.
You know, eat your heart out. You know?
We need more beautiful women around David Traub. And then it says, what has this guy got that no one else has got?
Yeah, what's cyber
somehow, space.
That's
Amore.
That's Amore.
Is it?
That sure beats cold.
Camera's eye, pizza pie, a heavy sigh, that's Amore.
Here's a was built on the idea that when you can start to connect the minds, connect the neurons and the synapses between individuals, that you start to get a collective wisdom. Some of us remember it as the beehive principle or swarm theory, but it's really more than that, because what we're talking about is the ability to start to look at a metaphor that leverages not individual empowerment, but leverages the socializing experience of minds being able to join together in ways that are very hard for us to predict. Because
on Web Earth, I've attempted to articulate one particular dimension of that vision. You, creating the human presence in cyberspace, articulate another. And perhaps we soon converge. The success of products like the Palace and Alpha World, which must be admitted as immature technologies, prove the existence of a powerful drive to connect. Because connection is the only thing in that space. Because connection is the only thing in that space, in cyberspace, which is real. It's the only thing that persists after the servers go down and the network's jammed. An avatar then serves one purpose above all, as a vehicle.
Excuse me, wait. Excuse me, I'd like two drinks. Dude, you go. That's not my guy. Oh my god, he's dead! Oh god.
What's the matter? My I'm back from the dead. I'm killing my pig.
Because they aren't dancing, they're like, shh.
This is an interesting kind of piece. We're talking about a new kind of digital soup simulation organism here.
It's not actually new. I posted something about this on the web last year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what?
But we're moving more towards realizing it now with Living Worlds.
Okay, now. Realizing the ability to create.
Are you recording this?
I'm recording it now.
Oh, okay, cool.
Okay. So, could you describe for our audience the basic concept here?
The basic concept?
Yeah.
The basic concept is, in Living Worlds, you have a pilot, and you have a bunch of drones, right? And these drones are running some part of the simulation on them, right? Part of the concept is to run the brain or the non-deterministic stuff in the pilot and to run an engine or deterministic stuff in the drones. But suppose each of the drones has a separate little piece of the computation that the pilot needs to do. Say the pilot wants to do a little learning for his neural network. The pilot then sends off little bits of computation to each of his drones. Now what this means is the more people are browsing a particular pilot, the more machines are running copies of his learning code. He's learning faster, he gains some sort of selective advantage.
Can an avatar be a pilot? I mean.
Sure. Well, all this runs on top of Avatar Worlds, right? Essentially, it's the whole principle, like in Oz, of any virtual world can be a multi-user world, and any multi-user world can have artificial life forms that live in it.
That are combined with artificial life forms that have live human-mediated behavior.
Right.
As
and
well.
If you look at this thing, if you walk into a virtual world and you look at this thing, it will run a little bit of its brain on your machine, and it will probably not take too many cycles to notice. But what will happen then is that the smarter critters presumably will evolve better and will learn to seek attention. They will want to be browsed by as many people as possible, and therefore will form themselves into the most interesting forms. In fact, the most interesting forms will be selected for, because the people coming and browsing them will cause them to actually send out more cycles and gain select an advantage by being smarter. Okay.
Kenny, you're saying everybody's
on your,
a pilot?
On your, everybody's a pilot, but only on their own machine. In your machine, you are a pilot, and everybody else is a drone.
What just happened? And then it's... Come on. There we go. And then it's like...
Except the, your normal browser wouldn't go out of focus. All those
bits
would be in focus.
Oh, here, let's zoom in a little. There you go.
Try that. Yeah. Well, that's really cool. See... And so you
can just pick one of those squares, and that's your world. So it's like as a portable teleporter, for instance.
Yeah, very portable teleporter. Maybe you could put it in the squares that your favorite world, like bookmarks. And these worlds will be like bookmarks.
Sure. Okay. Each of those ones will be. It start as a little tile, a little rich tile. So it'll be, each of those will be an image.
Of course.
You zoom in to the image, and you get really close, like the proximity sensor. You trigger the proximity sensor, and you pop to that world.
Yeah, we are navigating.
Yeah. Here we go.
Keep something, it says. It says replace the lamp? Have you used it that much?
No, it's an erroneous message.
Strange.
It tells you things. Everything's perfect.
So the idea is that even if, I mean, this may be...
Yeah. Having that happen, right?
Just makes it into...
Yeah, just think. Okay, wait. We got to do the whole...
Yeah, so what do we have here?
Okay, so it's Bruce Damer.
Early days of his avatar hood.
Yes. Even before it's converted to a flash pixel image, this is in Photoshop here.
Goes deep.
Yeah.
It's deep.
I would like to get these eyeballs to be like fully resolvable at this resolution.
This man is mad! Full resolution of this. Why stop there?
Right, why stop there?
Why stop there?
Why stop?
Someone was talking about zooming into the bacteria.
Yeah, let's see what kind of bacteria he's got in his eye here.
Yeah, well, I think I want to edit this out. You can see it, all the different lighting we had on here, huh?
Well, that's the light zone. That might be bacteria there.
Well, this light here, these two lights here are the two lights that we're getting.
The flash, reflection, right?
Yeah. And this is from the camera flash. So it's obvious that these contributed. These were very critical for the shadow.
Like these two here. How come it has two?
You see, we did good. Look at the lighting on this face. I mean, this is like
you did good.
There's
not a lot of shadows.
Perfectly reasonable. The ears are a
little
off.
What you were looking for. You were looking for the light and shadows and stuff. That was your focus.
This is our first feedback test.
That's right. I was trying to make those all even.
And that worked really well.
And we just happened to catch one with a decent depth of field. So, at any rate, let's see. We're going to close that one.
Which one is this one?
Cancel
or
that. Save? Now, we're going to save this on the disk.
This is number 64.
Yeah, we're going to save it on this hard disk front that might be using the RGB from Bruce's head, but we're going to be using the geometry from a cyberware scan, which is a completely different head.
So it might be his hair, but not his head.
That's right. Well, we need to capture Bruce's geometry. We still don't have Bruce's geometry. All we have are these.
Yes.
And as it turns out, we don't have an appropriate reference point to take 3DT avatar from the... You know, we had to have this little white square of paper to see it, to make the images look 3D.
Wow.
Yeah. Without the little white squares of paper, the image is J2D.
The next rev in terms of that.
Composite these images here. We're going to make a cut somewhere around here.
Why the compositing?
Why the compositing? You composite the images because you want to have a full-on shot in this direction, and you also have to have a full-on shot straight onto the face. You want to be shooting down to that and onto that, so that when you texture map, you minimize the amount of distortion that you're incurring.
Well, so you want the sharpest pictures initially, huh?
Yes.
You want to get really, and this is a good ear shot.
Yeah. Here we go. I'll zoom in on that just to.
That is an excellent ear shot.
There it
is.
Amazingly clear. Bruce's little pink ears. There they are, down to the little hairs in his ear.
God.
Yeah, people are going to be examining Bruce and seeing features of his face he didn't even know he had.
I'm kind of glad.
Don't you wish you were the first one out?
First one out of the gate.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so that's 66.
This is
quite the amazing image here.
That's a good shot.
Yeah.
Good choice. Good choice. Good color too. I'm impressed. This isn't even with a super high res screen.